Hello and welcome to Sideways Live Podcast. I'm Leanne Elliott.
And I'm Al Elliott. Hello.
And hello, hi. And we're here to just chat about to some people who live their lives just a little bit differently.
Yeah, I think that's if you've listened to the last episode, you'll know that we've changed our name from Travelers to A Sideways Life. And it's specifically because we are now looking to interview people and collect stories of people who are living life just a little bit differently.
I love a good story.
Me too.
Mm-hmm.
Me too.
So today we are talking to a lovely couple called Natalie and Daniel. They are originally from Tennessee in the USA and are currently living in Abu Dhabi in the UAE.
Mm.
That's exciting.
It is. Well, it's somewhere that we've always talked about but never necessarily been on our list. But after listening to them, it is
strong. Oh, it's so high on our list.
Yeah, really, really cool.
So what was your favourite bit?
I think just at the beginning, what was really cool was when we were chatting, we realized how similar our philosophies were. And I think that was really interesting at the beginning of the conversation is that, I mean, they're even called, I think, Wayward Life, is it? Our Way?
Yeah, Our Wayward Life.
And we're called Our Sideways Life. And it's pretty much the same idea. And they were just, it was just exciting to hear. Well, not exciting, but just really interesting to hear that we might be on the right lines with a sideways life because these were people who were very, very similar.
Yes, what kindred spirits.
What about you?
I liked them listening to how they travel, where they travel, how they do it quite slowly and very purposefully and what they do when they get there. They know how to have an adventure.
Yes, they do. We're not going to tell you any more than that, but the way in which when they arrive somewhere, they have kind of almost like a template of how they get to meet local people and see cool things.
Mm-hmm.
They do something very specific, and that's definitely worth listening to because it's something we're definitely going to be doing. We've done accidentally in the past, but never deliberately.
No.
Also, do you remember when they said, we said, so what were the options before you were moving to UAE?
Honestly, you could give me 20 guesses and I would never have shortlisted those three places to move to.
Mm-hmm.
No.
And certainly not together. They're very, very different.
Yes.
But they've got a good reason for that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Have a listen, you'll find out the reason for that. And I think both of our favourite bits in that was the riddle.
Yes, watch out for the story of the riddle.
It is great. Really, really good. Really good. And if you ever go to Georgia, then look out. You might be asked the same riddle. Oh, okay. Have I just spoilt it? We talk about Georgia. Forget that bit.
Oh, scrap it.
Yeah. Oh, I'll edit that out. Don't worry. Okay, so without further ado, are we introducing Natalie and Daniel?
Yes.
So here's Natalie and Daniel.
Here's Enjoy. Natalie and Daniel.
Hey, by the way, we'll see you at the end of this episode where we'll talk a little bit more.
Debrief. So today we are talking to Natalie and Daniel, who are expats living in the UAE in Abu Dhabi. Hi, how are you guys doing?
Good, how are y'all?
Good, thank you. Good. Thank you so much for taking the time. I mean, just to give our listeners a bit of a glimpse of your current situation, you're in quarantine right now.
Yes, because we just traveled. So we came back to Abu Dhabi from the Seychelles and we have to spend 10 days in our apartment wearing these lovely tracking devices.
Oh, really?
Wow.
Yes. And they have to be charged for 4 hours a day and the charger doubles the size.
Wow. So you stuck to the wall for 4 hours a day or is it like a portable thing?
No, it's portable.
Wow.
Like an electronic tag.
Yeah. It's okay. We have a balcony. We like our apartment. We're working online. It's okay.
What's the weather like over there right now?
It's pretty warm. We say Fahrenheit. So like 85, 90, 95 degrees every day.
Wow. So what's that about? 36, 35, something like that?
Yeah, like 35, 36.
Wow. That is hot. So it's no real harsh.
Oh, it's just starting. It's just starting.
Really?
How hot does it get?
In the summer months, like July and August, it could be up to 50, 52.
Oh my God.
And it's also extremely humid here because we're on the water. So, yeah.
So how do you cope that kind of temperature?
Everywhere is air conditioned. It's like being in Las Vegas or something where it's scorching hot outside. And then when you go in, you're just freezing because the air condition's on so high. Yeah. And all the pools are nice and chilled.
Ugh.
fabulous. Well, we'll definitely talk a bit more about that. But I mean, first, tell us a bit more about you, who you guys are, what you do for a living. We can hear that you're from the United States. How did you get to Abu Dhabi?
Well, let's see. So we met when I was 15 and Daniel was 19. We met at church in Tennessee, and we became friends and we started dating. Yeah, I had just turned 18 and he was 22 when we started dating, and we got married a few years after that, and we've been together ever since. So I would say, like, being from the South, a lot of people live like a cookie cutter style of life. And so they get married fairly young, and then they have babies fairly young. They get one job and stay in it for a very long time. And we were on that path.
Very much so.
And thought that's what we wanted just because that's what everybody else did. And then one day we were just like, it's not for us. So yeah, we just
quit our jobs.
And yeah, sold everything we have and made the move to the UAE. Had never been here before, didn't know anyone in the country. And I applied through a Teach Away for teaching abroad, because we wanted to travel, and we were thinking, well, we still have to make money. How can we make money and travel? And so since I was an English teacher, it worked out well to teach overseas. And yeah, we narrowed it down to the Middle East, China, and South Korea. And we're okay with all those possibilities. And we ended up here in the UAE.
They're quite bold choices. What narrowed it down to those three? I mean, you said it so casually, but the UAE, China, and South Korea.
Yeah. So what our major points for narrowing it down was, like, who offered the best package and who offered flights home every year, covered our housing, and would help with visa expenses. And the reason we didn't go South Korea is because I can't sponsor Daniel in South Korea. And so, or that was the case in 2015. And so if he didn't find a job within like 30 days that would sponsor him, he would have to fly out. And there's not, it's not like you can drive somewhere from South Korea. Like, you have to fly out. And then China was a really amazing option, but
it's really cold.
The winters are really long and really cold in China. And so we had originally said, like, we didn't even want to think about the Middle East because of all of the, you know, preconceived notions that we had about it. And it ended up being the best possible option. And I can't imagine having ended up anywhere else.
No, it's one of the best decisions we ever made. You
know? Yeah.
And then when you tell everybody you're going to the Middle East, they're just like, really? Why? And then you get here and you send them pictures and like, no, that's not the Middle East. That's what you're out on today.
Yeah, even we send pictures and videos home and people still just don't believe, like, how safe we are and how nice it is here and all the options that we have. But yeah, I think that's one of the best things about living here is that we have the opportunity to then share, like, what the Middle East is actually like to people back in America and help open their eyes a little bit, maybe.
So what are the preconceptions that people have of UAE, do you find?
I wouldn't say the UAE in particular, but the Middle East in general. People assume that if you're not Muslim, that they will not like you. And that they are not a very tolerant and welcoming people, that you would, that coming here, a lot of people assumed that I would have to, like, cover my hair, dress very conservatively. You can't have alcohol. Women can't drive. And none of that is true.
I mean, you can look at me, you know, long hair, tattoos, and one of my favorite things is to run. And I had local men and women pull over on the side of the road and give me water as I was running. Because they say it's too hot for you to be outside.
Really?
Yeah.
So they're very welcoming people.
That's cool.
I mean, their whole a lot of the country is built around expats. I think 80% expat in the UAE, only 20% local. And so I don't know if those numbers are exactly correct. But, you know, they've built, especially the main cities like Abu Dhabi and Dubai, they've built them for expats. So, you know, they have all the Western shopping stores. They have all the Western chain restaurants. They want you to feel welcome and happy and enjoy your life here so that you stay.
And how is it to work there? I mean, one of the things that we hear about the UAE is that it's very expensive, but it's also where salaries are very high and taxes very low. I mean, financially, how does it all work?
Well, for us, it's a lot better than working in America because our salary is tax-free, which is amazing. I should say I work in education here. I think I said that, but I work for the government education. So that's the only experience I can reflect on. Mm-hmm. But I would say overall, the salaries are much better, or maybe the salary isn't that much better than your home country, but the benefits are much better, such as like you don't have to pay taxes, or you don't have to pay housing, or you don't have to pay your health care. Mm-hmm. So it feels like you're earning a lot more. Like I know for us, our housing is covered. I don't think that's the case anymore, like if you were to come as a new teacher in the public school, but our housing is paid for. We get really good health insurance. Up until last year, we got annual flights home, and we get a bonus at the end, like whenever we decide to resign. Basically, for every year that I work, I get a 1 month bonus. Yeah, which is because, you know, obviously, like there's not a retirement fund here. So right. That's kind of like your retirement. Right. But it is expensive here. Mm-hmm. Like we went to Melbourne for Christmas in 2019, and our friends were like, oh, just be prepared. It's so expensive. We were like, same as Abu Dhabi. You don't think anything about going to a bar and paying $20 for a cocktail. Yeah, but you don't have to spend that. There are much better deals.
So. I'd say we found that in Melbourne as well, quite a shock coming, because we actually came from, I think, Indonesia. We flew out from Indonesia, where a beer is like $1. And then got to Melbourne, we're like, oh my God. Quite a shock.
Definitely. We kind of have the opposite of that now. When we go back to the States, we're like, oh my God, beers are $4. Buy all the beers. Like, yes, I need 11 right now.
So if anyone out there is considering the UAE as an option, what tips would you give them? What advice would you give them? How would they even go about starting that journey there?
So if they're in education, I would definitely say to go through a recruiting company such as Teach Away, Teach Anywhere. I think there are multiple options now, because that way you can see multiple jobs on one platform. If you come for the private schools, have a very different experience, but still amazing. Public schools, you could have. It's luck of the draw. You know, if you come to the UAE on a public school contract, you could be placed anywhere in the country. So you may be like in the mountains of Fujairah or out in the middle of the desert in Ruwais, or you could be in Dubai or Abu Dhabi. So I think the main thing is you have to be flexible.
Very flexible.
I thought I was flexible like as a professional before I moved here. Now I'm just like Stretch Armstrong or Gumby. Like they could throw anything at us and we'd be like, that sounds right. I think that one thing that we always say to people is that you have to remember that it's not your home country. And so don't expect it to be, because so many people there.
They're like, well, that's not the way we do it at home.
You're not at home. You're a guest in their country. And they've made it, you know, very accommodating for us. And so all they ask is for you to be respectful in return. Mm-hmm. You know, like, obviously, like we have, like right now it's Ramadan. And so Ramadan is the holiest month for the Muslim community. And you know, like they ask us not to eat or drink in public, unless you're like at a restaurant. It's not that hard to do that. When they're in return, you're getting accommodation and a very nice tax-free salary.
You're very well looked after.
Yeah, you're very well looked after. Yeah. But I would say flexibility is the biggest thing that you have to be flexible and be able to just roll with the punches. You think you know what's going to happen day in and day out, and it's never the case. You'll never be bored here, that's for sure.
Can you give us an example of one of those times where something unexpected has happened? Or?
Oh, absolutely. We have thousands of these examples. Actually, we say that every day, one of our friends told us this, every day you should have a what the fuck moment. And the day that you don't have those, you need to get on a plane and leave. Like, it's time for you to get out of here. Yeah, I would say at school, like, you know, we walk in one day and we've got our lessons planned out. Our students are going to come in. And all of a sudden they're like, oh, just kidding. The crown prince is coming today and we want you to speak to him in Arabic. And I'm like, okay, yeah, no problem. I got this. I don't speak Arabic. Yeah, and get the kids ready because they're going to give a presentation. And like, about what? Anything. And we've got 5 minutes. And we're like, okay, wonderful. Wow. That's, I think that's more specific to my school. It's a bit, it's like a high profile school. That we get a lot of attention, but if you have to be that flexible anywhere you go. Like, you make plans, you might as well just throw them out the window.
And are you in education as well, Daniel?
No, I'm not. I run a small business from home, so I don't get to leave the house as much as she did.
What did your business do?
I make custom leather products, purses, wallets, whatever, and it's all out of camel leather.
Wow.
That's cool.
So it's unique for the region.
Yeah. So before we moved here, Daniel was a fireman and also worked in facilities management. And when we moved here, that just, it wasn't an option. That was something he discovered he could do once we moved here.
It sold to everybody. Until COVID, I had a store in the US, a couple places in the UK that was carrying it. But since COVID, it's kind of slacked off, but it's mainly just online and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's a lot of like commission pieces though, like pick out your own, like he stains it, he sews it, he cuts it all.
Wow. So where will we find that, Daniel? Where can we look at your work?
DC Custom Leather Designs.
On Facebook.
Brilliant. We'll link that in the show notes.
Yeah, we'll send you the link. Yeah.
So can you tell us a bit about Our Wayward Life?
Our Wayward Life is just it's reflective of our journey, that we didn't want that cookie cutter rat race style of life, that we wanted to do something different. And we feel like we just have a bit of like wayward spirit in our souls. And yeah, so we just harnessed it and
away we went. And when we travel, we always do, I guess, stuff a little different than everybody else. We don't do the tourister stuff. We don't like going to like the big, you know, somebody's like, you got to go to this restaurant, whatever. My favorite thing is, or our favorite thing is going to a new country and going into a restaurant and being the only non-local person in there. We were in Armenia or Georgia, one of those countries, and a guy walked out of the kitchen. He said, somebody told me there was Americans here. We have never had an American in this restaurant. I was like, well, now you've got to.
Yeah.
We had a similar experience in, not Mandalay, where was it? In
Yangon. In Myanmar.
Yeah, we went to the same thing. I think we do the same thing as you. We just walk along and try and find a restaurant that looks a bit scary. And then just we walked in and it was exactly that. We were the only sort of non-Malaysian people. Not Malaysian, Burmese people. And it was, they were looked after so well. They brought around the plate and everyone else was eating with their hands. And the guy came around with literally a bucket and a ladle. And he just put like, he'd come around with rice. And then a bucket of curry would go on top. They'd be like, no, what do you want? It's like, that's what you're having. But
we were about halfway through and then this young lad came running in with some plastic forks that he'd found. Do you want these? We were like,
aww.
But then we still got stuck in with our hands and it was cool. But exactly like you said there, it's just people look after you and they're so pleased that you've come into their place.
They want to share their culture, don't they, and their food. And
yeah, I think that, part of our wayward life is like, we see some people who travel and, you know, everybody travels for their own reasons. And so do what works for you and what makes you happy. But one of the main reasons we travel is to actually experience other cultures. And if you only stick to, you know, like bus tours and walking around following somebody with a flag with 100 other people going to the most famous sites and clicking a million pictures, you don't really experience the culture. Maybe you do see some places, but for us, we like to
find the most famous places.
One thing we try to do when we travel, if we can, is try to do a local food tour if it's available, or even just find somebody like an Airbnb host and be like, hey, like, can you show us around some of the local restaurants or bars? And it ends up being, you know, like a history tour, a culture tour, the food tour, usually the local drinks. And we've really connected with some local people that we're still in touch with because of these things.
Amazing.
Yeah. So I would say our wayward life kind of harnesses all of that, just bucking the norm a bit.
What, is there an experience that stands out in terms of the local food tour?
We had one in Prague.
Yeah.
It was like right before Christmas Eve.
Yeah, maybe a day or two before Christmas.
This guy lived in somewhere in the States. I can't remember exactly where it was, but his English was perfect. And we did the tour And this guy ended up being one of the neatest people ever. Like his history tour was amazing. The stuff he knew about the city was amazing. And then he's like, oh, I'm only supposed to take you to these places. And he's like, let me show you where we really need that. And then he took us off the beaten path to the most random places. And we went in this one restaurant. There was only two tables in there. And they ended up asking another couple to move over so we could sit down. And we ate with these local people. And it's just kind of like, this is absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
It spoke zero English in there.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
So what are your other highlights? Where else have you been that stands out?
We love everywhere we've been. I can't think of a place we wouldn't go back to, except that we want to go to other places. Yeah. But like, we would go back to everywhere we've traveled. But I would say one of our favorites was Thailand. Mm-hmm. We could definitely see ourselves living in Thailand for a good bit.
Yeah.
If we move to Thailand, we probably won't ever move anywhere else. The Seychelles.
Yeah.
Germany. Yeah, we went to Munich, and it was the week before Oktoberfest, and we didn't know we were going to have the break from school. It was the Eid holiday after Ramadan, and we came back to school from summer, and we had 1 week, and then they're like, oh, surprise, you have the whole week off. So we just booked tickets for like the next day and hopped on a plane and had like the lead up to Oktoberfest week. So it was kind of like Oktoberfest, but on a much smaller scale.
And half the price.
And half the price, yeah.
That's a really good tip if anyone wants to do Oktoberfest then, but perhaps with all the crowds.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they had the street bands, they had the polka bands, they had everything going. All the beer stalls were open, and they're like, oh, yeah, you come back next week, and it's double the price. And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm here this week.
And accommodation was a good bit cheaper, too, that week.
Amazing. But that's how we're going to do Oktoberfest. Yes. We've always talked about doing it, but never have.
No, genius. Was it Munich we were in when it was the World Cup?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was Germany were playing, weren't they?
Did you like Munich?
Yeah, we were only there for one night. We were actually driving from the UK to Romania.
Romania, yeah, I think it's Romania.
Yeah, so it was one of our stops. But we were there the day that, I don't know if you guys followed the Soccer World Cup a couple of years ago, but it was it was in the group match and they had to win it. And we just ended up in that. We did a walking tour, didn't we? And ended up in this beer garden at the end with just thousands and thousands of people. It's the biggest thing I've ever seen. It was huge. With these huge, like, what they call the beer? The glasses?
Oh, the
stein.
Yeah, like exactly, stein. Exactly.
It's like bicep curls.
Like two hands in it, and yeah, and a bit of effort. But yeah, it was amazing. And then Germany won. They scored in like the last 30 seconds, and all of a sudden everyone's jumping up, you're covered in beer, and yeah, even as you know, British
amazing.
People were end up like cheering, going, yeah, come on, and then we get home and we're like, Yeah, football wise, so
oh,
it was
fun.
But yeah,
what was Georgia like? Because we've always wanted to go there.
Oh, so,
we loved it.
Yeah, so we were there for Christmas. We did Armenia and then took a van from Armenia to Georgia. We were only in Tbilisi, but I would say like, yeah, the food is really nice. If you like hearty, stick to your bones type of food, so, and like during the winter, it was really comforting.
It's all like meat and stews and stuff like that.
They have these dumplings called kinkali. It's like, oh man, they're just like really nice Georgian dumplings. And then there is the wine is incredible and so cheap. And because it's like most of it's local wine, you could drink like an entire bottle, maybe more than one, I don't know, from experience. And you would not even have a headache the next day. Yeah. And then we were there, it was on Christmas Eve, and because they celebrate Orthodox Christmas, so it wasn't Christmas Eve for them. And we were wandering around trying to find something to do. And we saw a flyer for a wine and beer festival. And we're like, oh, we'll check it out in the park. And it was freezing cold, like 0 degrees.
Yeah,
it was really, really cold. And it was 5 Georgian lari to get in, which is like $1.50. And then you just can sample, there was 30 small batch wineries, and we could sample wine from all of them. And then they had a few beers and some local food. And yeah, it was local music. It was amazing.
Wow.
Yeah, because we said we'd go for an hour or two, and I think we ended up spending like 6 or 7 hours.
Yeah, you missed Christmas and woke up on Boxing Day.
Yeah. And also in Georgia, we went to some of the monasteries, and that was really, really good.
Yeah.
And because it was cold, not many tourists were there. And so we were some of the only people at the monastery, and you could hear like a monk chanting like while we were there. It was kind of like echoing throughout the whole monastery. It was amazing.
Wow. So whereabouts in Georgia did you go? Was it the capital?
Just Tbilisi. I don't know where that monastery was. A driver took us. Maybe it was only
Yeah,
forty-five
it's like
minutes outside
45
of the
minutes.
city. We would love to go back and do the winery region or the wine region.
So is that quite an affordable thing to do as well? Get a driver to take you to place it further out?
Yeah,
Yeah,
I
we
think
had
so.
him all day and he drove I don't know how long and it was $50 and he drove all over the place.
We met him at a local restaurant, or met one of his colleagues at a local restaurant, and it was this teeny tiny burger joint that had like three tables, and the guy who owned it came out and he told us a riddle, and he was like, okay, he's like, I'm gonna pour you a shot of,
Some kind of rum.
I can't remember what the local, a rock
Yeah.
maybe, the local drink. And he was like, if you get the riddle right, I'll pay for the shot, but if you get it wrong, you have to pay for the shot, but you have to drink it either way. And we didn't get the riddle right, but we paid for the shot, and so we took some more shots, and this guy came in and he was like, oh, you're traveling tomorrow? And we're like, yeah, we want to find a driver. He's like, no, I call my friend for you. And yeah, this guy, I think he worked for the embassy, and it was his day off, so worked out well for us and
Do you
for
remember
him.
what the riddle was?
I remember the answer to it. That's all I remember. It was like something that no one wants.
No one wants to lose.
Yeah, something that you don't want to have, but no one wants to lose it.
I don't know, do you?
No, I'm out.
I think we guessed like tomato. Which is not the correct answer. It was a lawsuit.
That's clever. Yeah,
Yeah.
we wouldn't have got
No, but if we ever
that.
find ourselves
I wouldn't have
in
either.
a Georgian bar, if
Yeah.
someone asks a riddle, we'll feel like,
Yep.
yeah.
You'll know.
That's definitely on our
Shots
list
on
of
you.
yeah, definitely on our list of places we want to go, but we travel with our dogs, so we drive. And so just driving through, so driving through
Oh.
Turkey is just a little bit scary for us, I think. You know, we drove through
Yeah.
Bulgaria and that was and Albania, and that was scary enough. But I think we're just a little bit we're a bit wimps when it comes to driving through like Russia or Turkey.
We require a lot of
Yeah,
research, I think.
understandable. Yeah,
Yeah.
definitely. Which part of Albania were you
We're
in?
in we're near
We're near Corfu,
Tirana.
Smil first,
Oh yeah.
Okay.
and then we drove up to, Tirana.
Yeah, Tirana. We came from Greece, didn't we? Through Albania, is that right? Yeah. Have you been, did you say?
Yeah, so we went maybe like summer 2019. I think that was our trip. So usually in the summer we travel back to the States for about 3 weeks and then come back to the UAE and then travel for like our actual holiday for 10 days or whatever we have left of the break. And so we went to Corfu and then took the ferry over to Saranda, Albania, and we stayed there for about a week. And it was amazing. Yeah.
Oh, we loved it.
Yeah. I would go back to both. Definitely want to spend more time in Corfu. We were only there for a few nights, so we didn't get to go to like the beaches. We were just in the old town. But yeah, we want to go to the north of Albania and do the accursed mountains. It just sounds so badass. Like I stayed in the accursed mountains.
Don't think I've heard of them, have you? No.
You have to look them up. Man,
They're
they're
beautiful,
beautiful.
really.
Cool. So, I mean, I think one thing you said that really resonates with me, and I'm sure it did with you as well, is that what you said about getting into that, into the rut of life and just doing things because, people expect it. It's just the way it's done. I mean, if anyone's out there kind of struggling in that same struggle that you were in 5, 6 years ago, what would you say to them?
I know it's not possible for everyone, but I would just say, just do it. Just take the leap because your hometown or wherever it is that you're stuck currently will always be there. Maybe not the same job, but like that place will always be there. So if you go somewhere and you don't like it, fine, you can go back
Always come
home.
back.
But if you don't do it now, when will you do it? If you're trying to wait to like, oh, I need to wait for this financial situation or this personal relationship, it's like, make it happen. It's not gonna work out for you on its own. You have to like actively work for it. If that's what you want to do, you can't just wait for your dreams to happen. You have to go after them.
Yeah, you either gotta get off the ledge or jump.
And everywhere, like if you're looking at a destination like the UAE or that somewhere else that's popular for expats, you'll find a community. you have to be willing to put yourself out there. But like, I think that's one of the scariest parts is like, well, I don't know anybody. Like, who will show me around? Who will I ask my questions to? But like now with social media, you can reach out to people months or years before you decide to move and learn about the place and get in touch with people, and they can share their personal experiences. And even if, like us, you arrive not knowing a soul, we had talked to one person before we moved here. And, you know, you join the Facebook groups, make friends with your colleagues, and you don't just have to be friends with people from your home country. A lot of people do that. They move to a place and find their bubble of, like, all the same people. They basically just picked their lives up and moved it to a new country, but doing all the same things, like, you know, making friends with different people from different cultures, different backgrounds. We're part of a running group here. I don't run, Daniel does. It's really a drinking group, but we also run. And that has been one of the best things that we did. We joined that within a month of moving to the UAE, and that's where we have made some of the absolute best friendships that we've ever had. And, you know, people of all different ages, all different cultures. It's amazing.
So what does the future look like? Are you going to stay in the UAE? What are your plans?
That's the million-dollar question.
Yeah, I think we'll definitely be here at least one more academic year, but we could stay longer. We never know kind of like how our contracts may change, because things can change really, really quickly here. And especially with COVID, a lot of people have, you know, chosen to leave or have lost their jobs. Not so much in the education sector, but yeah, so I would say we'll be here at least one more academic year, but maybe a few more years. We're really happy here. We don't want to leave until we really have a reason to leave. Mm-hmm. So until we feel like there's a specific opportunity for us elsewhere, or we're just really done with Abu Dhabi. Yeah, but we're happy, so.
I mean, for anyone traveling to Abu Dhabi in terms of like tourism, how do you best navigate that in a similar way that you mentioned, so to want to have perhaps more local experiences?
Yeah, so right now it's only open for tourism if you're willing to do the quarantine mm-hmm. period of 10 days, or if you're coming from a green list country, right. Which I think there's 10 or 12 countries and they update every 2 weeks, but in normal times, yeah, there's a million different like tour operations here.
And you don't want to do that. I mean, you can go to the Grand Mosque. It's one of the prettiest buildings I've ever been in.
They call it the eighth wonder of the world.
Yeah, Sheikh Zayed's Grand Mosque is absolutely beautiful. Then you get the downtown area that does like all the souks, and they got gold souks where you can just walk around and you can buy bar gold if you really feel like it.
Yeah, and then there's, you know, like we have the Louvre Museum in Abu Dhabi now. There's plenty of beaches to go to, and there's all sorts of, you know, like cultural sites. Like we have Qasr al-Hosn, which is like an old kind of fort from the city, and then there's Qasr al-Watan, which is part of the presidential palace, and it's like a archive, like a library kind of archive that you can go see. But it's everything is just so exquisite and extravagant. It's amazing. And then there's all sorts of like world's highest this and world's largest this, water parks, theme parks.
Yeah, lots to do.
My friend talks about going camping in the desert.
Oh, it's one of the most amazing things. You go out there, and like there's a spot that we go out, and it's actually underneath the Milky Way site, and there's no lights, there's no light pollution or anything. And you just sit there and you just look at the stars.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then every time you're desert camping, we go desert camping probably twice a month during the cooler months, and sometimes every weekend. But every time we go desert camping, you're on someone's farm essentially, but it's okay to camp there. And there will be camels that just like roam through your campsite.
Wow.
Yeah. Every morning you wake up and they're just like.
Yeah, there's 100 camels.
Yeah, 100 camels standing outside your tent.
That is amazing.
Something that's really telling about the culture here is a lot of people who would live in those like the desert areas, they might have quite a different lifestyle than those that would live like in the cities. And so a few times we went camping in this one area and the farmers were nearby. The man who owned the farm was nearby, and they had 7 kids, and the kids just came like running over the dunes while we're setting up. We're like, oh, are they going to like tell us to leave because it's their property? And they like brought us dates and coffee and water. And they were like, come to our farm. And so we didn't get to go because we had a COVID test appointment, but our friends went to their farm and they, you know, sat down and had lunch with the entire family. And we were up on top of a dune and the guy drove his truck all the way to the top of the dune. And we were like, oh, he's definitely going to like kick us out of here. And he was like, you stay here tonight? Do you need to come to my house? We you can sleep at my house. Like, they're just so lovely.
Amazing.
And you, like I said, we live in the city of Abu Dhabi. You know, we're 45 minutes away from the desert. Then it's 3 hours and you can be up in the mountains that are absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, there's hiking up through there. You can, there are several hikes that we've done before you can. Of course, you have to carry everything, your water, your tent, your backpack, but you hike it to the top of the mountain, and then in the morning, you sit there and watch the sun come up on top of the mountain. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, it's really nice because whether in Abu Dhabi or in Dubai, like you've got the beaches, and you know we've got some absolutely stunning beaches here, and then you've got the desert, and then you've got the mountains. And then if you go to in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, there's a city, Al Ain, and it's like an oasis. It's very green and lush. And so like you've got a little bit of everything just like in the same area. And a lot of people only think they're like, oh, hot and desert. They don't think about like all the other things that we have naturally. And yeah, like you were saying, everything's so close by. Like we're an hour from Dubai, which is amazing. Obviously, Dubai has a million things to do and to see. And it's an easy like weekend getaway.
Amazing. And then as you said, you've got all the kind of the conveniences and modern amenities as well. It's yeah.
Oh yeah. Everything delivers here. Alcohol, groceries,
pharmacies,
wow. Laundry.
Yeah.
Gas.
Yeah. You can have them, you can call and they will come and fill up your car with gas.
I could do 10 days in quarantine. Maybe we should just get on a plane.
Maybe.
Yeah,
it sounds incredible.
Yeah, just do 10 days quarantine at a nice hotel and you'll have your vacation.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. Well, if people want to find out a bit more about your life and your work and your travel, they'll find you on Instagram, Our Way With Life. And
absolutely.
Anywhere, anything. Oh, and we'll put in the link for Daniel's business as well. If you want to check that out. And are you happy for people to get in touch? Do they have any questions about moving to the UAE?
I would love to get in touch with anyone who has any questions or wants to talk about the UAE or expat life or just doing life a little bit differently.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for your time, guys. It's been lovely chatting to you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks for hosting us. We really enjoyed it.
Brilliant. All right. Thanks, guys. See you soon. Well, they were a lovely couple, weren't they?
They're just gorgeous.
Mm, amazing people. Mm-hmm. I think the audio was a little bit low on that. We're struggling to get decent software that can record good audio on both ends. So the apologies if the audio cut out a little bit in that, but we've done our best to increase the volume, etc., etc. But anyway,
so yeah, if you want to find out more about Natalie and Daniel, you'll find them on Instagram at Our Wayward Life.
That's our
Wayward. Yeah, our our Wayward Life. I'm just looking at their Instagram now, actually, and it's no wonder we're friends. Their description says, we love good food, strong drinks, adventures, and connecting with others.
Our new best friend. It's a bit weird if they listen to this. We're like, who are the creepy couple who just, won't leave us alone.
So if you want to find them on Instagram, it's Our Wayward Life. If you're interested in looking at Daniel's business, and the products are gorgeous, do take a look. You'll find him on Facebook at DC Custom Leather Designs, or you can email Daniel directly at dcleatherdesigns@gmail.com. We'll put everything below as well.
Yeah, you'll have all the links there. Cool. Okay, so we will be putting this on to our podcast mini site at asidewayslife.com. You should be able to see the show notes underneath and also a link to our website. Have a little look through it. It's a brand new site, so you'll have some of the old posts that are on Travelers, but generally it's a brand new site, so we'd love some feedback on it. And if you want to be a guest, if you live life a little bit sideways, then drop us a line. Go to our website, asidewayslife.com, and you'll see a contact form there. Or just go to Instagram.
Yeah, slide into our DMs.
I think we're too old to say.
I know.
Like
I feel uncomfortable.
It's like I heard the word salty before, and I still don't know what it means. So I don't know whether I'm allowed to use it or not.
I don't know. I'd imagine if you don't know what it means, then you're probably not meant to use it.
That's a good general way to live rule. Your life. Good. And on that, I need to say bombshell. Well, it's copyrighted that thing.
Oh, cut that bit out.
God, Clark's coming knocking me out, won't he? And on that, I think we'll leave it there. So go to asidewayslife.com and you'll be able to put yourself forward as a guest, find all of the other episodes and all the links we talked about.
And if you fancy dropping us a review while you're there, that would be nice. I believe it helps other people find us. That's what so I've heard cheesy. Other people say on their podcasts. I have no idea if it's true.
Actually, that's a really good point. If you give us, the more reviews you give us, we get, the genuine reviews, then the more likely we're gonna pop up in something called new and noteworthy. And that's where we find more. That's like the top.
It's like the charts.
It's the charts. God, the charts.
It's like top of the pops.
Do you remember them? So we need, we want your review. Please give us a review.
Yeah, if you've got 5 minutes. Unless you don't like it, in which case don't. Just keep scrolling.
Yeah, do what my mother used to say. If you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all.
And more words to live by.
Yeah, mm-hmm. There you go. Thanks, Pat Elliott. Anyway, so go to the website. Please do give us a review. And if you haven't subscribed yet, click that subscribe button. And every one of our beautiful episodes will slide into your podcast app like a... I can only think of a rude analogy. I won't go down that road.
Yeah. And while you're at it, go follow Natalie and Daniel on Instagram as well.
Yeah.
Our way with life.
Yeah, go find them.
Yeah.
Lovely people. All right, guys. Speak to you soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Well, that was a flawless performance. I'm not sure we have any outtakes.
I think you're right. You nailed it.
Nailed it.
Nailed it like a carpenter on payday.
Oh, you might need to cut out that bit about Jeremy Clarkson, though.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I remember to do that.
Yeah. You won't, will you?
No.